Hey there guys, Demo73 here, bringing you the feature match for the week. This is more of kind of a casual match. I went to Odyssey Games in Kalamazoo, really cool shop, little shop, and I played around with one of the employees there, Elliot Parkhurst. He is playing a red-green version of Matchstick Grimm. Very interesting take, some interesting tech choices in there. So we called it Matchflame Grimm. And then I am playing a red-black, splash-blue Nyarlathotep Cthulhu Incarnate with Banzai attack and with Rook Egg and with Atombrilli and stuff like that. I just thought it would be cool to try to give Nyarlathotep Incarnate another chance. And so that's what I did. So especially with Moonlit Savior coming out, I wanted to try something that was hadn't been seen in a bit to just have a good time and put up a fun match to watch. So let's go ahead and get right into it. Sorry about the glare. We tried to fix it as best as possible, but unfortunately we just couldn't get rid of most of it. So I hit that basic darkness stone off the top, and unfortunately don't have a first turn play. He's Greenstone, plays that Cheshire Cat, which is pretty standard for a Grimm player. Going into my turn, tap for a stone, get a Moonshade. So I play a King in Yellow. Play a Levitine, and then I discard the other Levitine in my hand to bring out a Rook Egg. And then I pass. As you can see, I have a Hoster in hand, so I'm ready to make use of Hoster as soon as he puts out something that I can kill. So he hits that Unyielding Flame Memoria, but because I have not taken any damage, it comes into play tapped. And you'll see why he has those Unyielding Flames more a little bit later in the match. It's actually a pretty interesting tech choice. So I burn myself for 200 damage to play a Rook Egg. Sacrifice King in Yellow and Rook Egg to play Hoster. So first off, one thing I could have done here is could have just swung in with King in Yellow. I mean, it's free damage before I did anything else. I will admit that I'm not playing the best that I could here, but I could easily swing in with King in Yellow to get some free damage in there. But it's not terrible. So the reason that I played the Rook Egg first before I played the Hoster is because Hoster has to kill something. And so when Hoster triggers, I'm going to have it kill my other Rook Egg so that I could get two more searches out. So I got a King in Yellow off the search from King in Yellow. I got a Guinevere off the search from the first Rook Egg, and I'm going to grab a second Rook Egg off of the second card. Those Cheshire Cats are a problem for Cthulhu Incarnate, unless I can get into something like a Yogg-Sothoth. But also, with my Levitine and Nyarlathotep, it makes it a little bit easier, because I can just do Judgment, and forces him to sac his Cheshire Cat, and then I can immediately swing in with Nyarl for 700 damage. So a pretty early flip, but still getting in that damage. The other thing is too, if he had if I had swung in with the King Yellow, he might have blocked it, which means that I could have just taken the time to tap for another stone and not have to worry about that Cheshire Cat being on board. Before untap, he's going to go ahead and search. He's going to pitch a... Let's see what he pitches here. Pitches a Glinda. And he searches for his one copy of Grimm the Avenger. It's a good choice against a Cthulhu player, because it's a free kill on any, you know, Darkness Resonator, which most Cthulhus are. So he taps for a stone. Plays a Gretel. Gets another stone. And then follows it up by playing that Grimm the Avenger to kill my Hoster. Which I go ahead and just sack to Levantine anyway. I don't want it necessarily to get removed from the game, but I at least have an answer. So go ahead and tap for a stone here. Burn myself for 200 to play a Guinevere. And then a King in Yellow. And I pass the turn. So I need to kind of reestablish. I need to draw into some incarnate stuff. Unfortunately, my hand has none of that right now. But with King Yellow and Guinevere, I can make those plays happen. So he swings in with the Grimm the Avenger, and I take the 500 damage. Taps three stones, plays a Snow White. And then swings at me, puts a counter, decides not to use the counter, and I just take another 500 damage. At the end of his turn, I'm going to use Guinevere, sack out the King in Yellow. King in Yellow triggers, getting me another King in Yellow. And then I get to draw two and discard one, hopefully drawing into some incarnate fodder. Or a Rasputin, which also helps fuel my cheaper incarnate stuff. So drawing into turn, tapping for a Levantine, get some additional damage if I can get a Cthulhu out this turn. Play a Rasputin. Pay 200 to play a Rootkeg. Send Rasputin and Rootkeg away for a Domberly. Both of those triggers are going to happen. I'm going to pay 200 to bring my Rasputin back to my hand, and then Rootkeg's going to trigger, and that's going to let me be able to search out Hoster. I'm in a good position here in the sense that I know he's already shipped away. I mean, most Grimm players are usually teching one of, so a lot of the like answerable stuff. So like that Grimm the Avenger, I'm thinking is probably his only one, which puts me in a pretty good spot. So I'm going to burn, with the Domberly, I'm going to burn the Gretel for 400 damage and then hit Elliot with a 400 point loss of life. Pay a black to play out a Rasputin. Bring out an Hoster. Pay 200 to bring my Rasputin back to my hand. And I'm going to kill Snow White. So now I'm in a position here where I could kill that Grimm, but I'm not really worried about it. I'd rather put a lot of pressure on Elliot and put him low life. So I'm going to go ahead and swing in and tap for a second Levantine swing, which means that I will be doing 1700 damage. So putting Elliot down to 12. Yes, I'll have to deal with his answers. But at the same time, I feel like this is a strong position for me to be in. That being said, when I was in the moment, I didn't know that he was playing Matchstick. So I was unaware of the fact that Matchstick Girl was about to be coming out and making some things happen. So during the uptap, he uses his Unyielding Flame of Moria on Grimm. That means that whatever Grimm deals damage this turn, he's actually dealing an additional 200. So essentially it's Levitine for creatures, for Resonators. And then he pitches a Tinkerbell to grab Matchstick. Now I'm starting to see, as soon as I see that Matchstick, I start to realize, that's what's going to be happening. Because he can use that Unyielding Flame to pump up the damage that Matchstick does every time she discards a magical Matchstick. Which is pretty potent. Elliot's figuring out how much he wants to pay for the Awakening for Matchstick Girl. Pay 5. So that means he's going to get to grab 3 magic matchsticks out of his deck. Pumps her up, each of those matchsticks is going to be able to deal 600 damage. So he discards the first one to burn my Hoster. I'm going to sacrifice it to Levitine, not that it really matters. He's going to attempt to burn on Yarmothota up here next by using 2. So 1 goes through, 2 goes through. I'm gonna sacrifice Levitine to give it imperishable because I know it's gonna die. Now I don't know, he has the third one in hand here, so he goes to swing in. And I go to block with the Domberly. I'm like, he's used his 3 matchsticks, even though it's dealing 700 damage. Domberly can survive it. But then he has the fourth one in hand, so he just pitches it, so we trade. So, really good play by Elliot there. Because now he's going to be able to search for Matchstick Girls and keep bringing those magical matchsticks back to his hand. So I decided to tap for a stone here. I could have gotten aggressive and played Rasputin, King in Yellow into Nyarlathotep and flipped my other Nyarlathotep. But I'm still going to do that, but I could have also flipped, you know, done Judgment this turn and put some additional pressure on. But I know that he could just search for another magical matchstick. Or a little match girl, so I have no way to give my Nyarlathotep imperishable, so that really doesn't make sense. So I'm gonna pay 200 to bring back Rasputin, and then I'm gonna look at his hand. So I'm gonna go ahead and pretty sure grab the Zeke's here, just because I don't want it to mess up my summoning play for next turn. Because I want to be able to flip Nyarlathotep next turn with that Byakki the Winged Lady I have in my hand. And I'm not terribly scared of Rapunzel just because of the fact that that'll take a while to set up, and if he does that, I'll be able to easily use my Flames of Outer World that I have in my hand. Use the other red, or the other black will that I have to replay the Rasputin. So now I have a couple creatures on board. And Rasputin against Match Girl is pretty fine. I'm okay with him using a match to kill Rasputin, because I can just bring it right back and he's essentially wasted a matchstick. With those two unyielding flames Moria's out now, though, she's going to be able to deal, potentially, 800 damage per match. So if he, you know, searches for another matchstick, plays it, gets all those matchsticks back, it's a pretty dangerous ability. You know, it's a pretty dangerous card. So he plays Blessing of Yggdrasil. This is, he's wanting to kind of ramp up a little bit more. So he has three heat blasting wave stones left. Plays Rapunzel. And passes the turn. So now I have the stones to be able to play King in Yellow and have Flames of Outerworld still. So sacrifice Rasputin and King in Yellow for Byakki. I'm not going to pay for Rasputin because at this point, I mean, I'm essentially going for game right now, or putting in a position to go for game right now. So I'm not, I don't really want to burn myself for any more life. So I have all four King in Yellows already in the grave, but it is a mandatory search, so I have to shuffle the deck. So now that I have these two on the board, I'm going to be able to flip over my Nyarlathotep. So I'm feeling pretty secure here in the fact that because I have the Flames of Outerworld, if he does pitch and search for another Match Girl, I can Flames of Outerworld it. Because I put him in a position here where he's probably not going to want to sacrifice... he's probably not going to want to sacrifice his Rapunzel. Most Grimm players don't, just because of the fact that they can get that flying. So he, in fact, does just that. He sacrifices the little Match Girl, which puts me in a position where now if he plays another one, I've got flames. So I'm not worried at all. So I attempt to swing in with Nyarlathotep in the same position here. If he decides to block, I can Flames of Outerworld Rapunzel easily and get that damage in. He decides to just take it, putting him down to 400, and it's times like these where I wish I had a Thunder in hand. Passes the turn. You'll see him tap for to try to pump her up, and he's going to untap it when we recover. Both of us actually just missed it, but I catch it shortly after that you can't. Rapunzel doesn't recover during the recovery phase, so essentially, because he has no other fairy tales in the hand, he has no way to recover her after we move into the main phase, and so he's just going to concede. So I see we recovered it, and then wait just a second, and you're going to see me catch that. How did she recover? Yep, you see me asked to read it real quick, and we both realize, oh wait, she can't recover during the recovery phase, and he's got no fairy tales in his hand, so he's just going to show and scoop. So moving into game two. So game two, he's going to be going first. Now that I know that there are those matchstick girls, I gotta be more careful. Because I don't want to get burned by those again. It's a very easy way for him to clear my whole board that he can do repetitively. Thinking about what to save, what to keep, what to send away. So he gets that first turn Tinkerbell, so obviously he's going to go a little bit more on the offensive here. Unfortunately, I hit a Moonshade off the top, so I have to start paying life right away, which is less than ideal for a deck that uses Rasputin. It's a second Greenstone. Plays a Cheshire Cat. He doesn't want to hit that Unyielding Flame Memoria quite yet. Puts that little Dread back on top of his deck, and then plays a second Tinkerbell. So, like I said, very, very aggressive right off the gate. So another 600 damage to me. Tapping for a second stone, hit a second Moonshade. This is super, super bad for me. I have to be paying life. I'm staring down a lot of really heavy hitting creatures that are just gonna get bigger if I don't have an answer. But I played that Mozart, and then I'm deciding whether or not I want to incarnate into Nyarlathotep or Hoster. I decide to go with Hoster just to get some answers off the board. He uses the Mozart trigger happens, and so does the Rasputin trigger. So I'd pay 200 life to bring Raz back to my hand. And then he sacrifices a Cheshire Cat to Mozart. Kind of an interesting play. I probably would have sacrificed the Tinkerbell. It would have mean that I lose both my Tinkerbells because Hoster would just kill the other one. But it also means that I would have a free wall. He's probably thinking that because he plans to play a bunch of Fairy Tales next turn, that he'd rather keep Tinkerbell on board to be able to make a better play. So taps, gets that Unyielding Flame Memoria, which I've already taken some damage, so now it comes into play recovered. Deciding whether he wants to play a Snow White or try to ramp up a little bit. Plays the Gretel, hits the Blasting Wavestone, and then follows it up with a Blessing of Yggdrasil to get the other Unyielding Flame out of the way. So now, if he plays a Gretel later, it won't whiff, and he's got both of those Unyielding Flames out. So, pretty good play. Sets him up better, as well as sets him up for his match to Girls to be right off the gate. Really, really strong. Tap for a stone, hit a Darkness Stone, play King in Yellow, pay 200, bring back Rasputin, sacrifice them both to play a Nyarlathotep, get the King in Yellow trigger and the Rasputin trigger, so bring Rasputin back to my hand for 200. I mean, I'm burning myself for a lot of life here, but I am gaining a lot of momentum. So in my eyes, it's kind of a trade-off, and I knew for a fact that this was going to be, especially seeing those Moonshades, where I'm just going to have to get put pressure on and not worry about my life so much. I see the Snow White, I see the Etna. I'm thinking about what I know about Grimm players, what would be more devastating to me. I make the call that he probably only has the one Etna, and so I make him discard that. Because Etna, he's in a position where he could lock down both of my creatures and then just start swinging for the fences, which would be really bad for me. So I decide to hit the Etna. Whereas the Snow White can be dangerous, but really only more so if he uses those Unyielding Flames. So I swing in for 700 damage with Hoster, and then pass the turn. There's one for Cheshire Cat. And then he's gonna he's deciding whether or not he wants to ramp up a little bit. Discards the Gretel. So he's deciding he doesn't want to ramp at this point. To grab the Grimm the Avenger, which we have seen before. Not surprising at this point. He's debating, it looks like, between Dorothy and a Grimm the Avenger. Pretty interesting idea here. I think the Grimm the Avenger is probably the best card, just because it's going to give him free removal and get a lot of pressure on with his Tinkerbell. Yeah, so he does grab the Grimm the Avenger. Especially if he has another Cheshire Cat on board, he can kill my Nyarlathotep and then swing his Tinkerbell. Even with just Grimm the Avenger, he can swing Tinkerbell into Hoster and it won't do anything. Plays. Yep. Pumps up Tinkerbell. Always. Whoa. Yeah, I tell him he can only do it once per turn. He tries to do a second Grimm pitch, but I remind him that he can only do it once per turn. So he actually swings for 1,000 damage at my face. And then he passes the turn. If I was in his shoes, I probably would have killed the Hoster. It's a pretty safe bet, and it helps get more of my stuff off the board. But, I mean, putting me in a position where it even hurts me even more every single time I have to incarnate, forcing me to kill myself is also pretty good. So I pay 200 here for Rasputin, putting me down to 1,200. And then again, I'm put in a position where I don't know exactly which ones I want to pull out. I'm going to go ahead and grab a second Hoster. I'm not going to bring Rasputin back to my hand, because at this point I am much too low on life. But I am going to be able to grab another King in Yellow. I'm going to kill Grimm the Avenger with my Hoster, flip over Nyarlathotep. He's going to sacrifice the Gretel. I do have the Levitine. I'm going to go ahead and try to kill the Tinkerbell with my Hoster. He's going to get thundered. Sacrifice it to Levitine, attempt to kill the Tinkerbell, which gets blocked with Cheshire Cat. Doing some math here, deciding what he wants to search for, because he's definitely going to search, or if he can just get lethal this turn. He's going to draw on a turn. He's going to pitch the Snow White. Oh no, he pumps up the damage that Tinkerbell is going to be doing this turn. He actually drew into a Match Girl, which is pretty convenient for him to be able to follow up next turn. He's going to pitch away the Snow White. If I was in his shoes, I probably actually would have pitched the Match Girl. And grab like a Gretel, because he would have probably been able to do lethal this turn, because he could play the Snow White, which makes Tinkerbell a 4-4, swing in for 5 and pump up how much damage the burn counter is going to do, so she can just burn my Hoster and then deal 700 damage, and then still have another be able to pump up Tinkerbell. So technically, it would have been 700 damage from 700 damage from Snow White, and then 600 damage from Tinkerbell, and would have been lethal. Especially since I'm tapped out. The Unyielding Flame of Moria is actually a really interesting tech. I'm really interested in it. I haven't seen anyone use that stone at all. So it was pretty cool to see that come out. So it's got one pump on it. So he decides to play the matchstick girl, and he's got to do an awakening on her to get a matchstick. Deciding how much he wants to awaken her for. Goes ahead and does 2. So he's gonna get a couple matchsticks there. So Tinkerbell's currently a 600-600 dealing 800 damage. So even if he pumps it up with Unyielding Flame one more time, it's only going to deal 1,000. He's going to pump up Matchstick Girl. He's going to burn Hoster. Going to sacrifice it to Labatine. Swings in for 1,000 damage. Swings it for 800 damage. And then I just admit defeat at that point. Because there's nothing I can do. So we're going to go into game 3. So here we are, game 3. Right off the top, I hit the little red pure stone, so I don't have to start killing myself, which is nice. I'm able to play that Rasputin. Taps for a stone. Hits a green stone off the top. And plays, guessed it, a Cheshire Cat. Pitches the magic matchstick back to the top just because he knows he can grab it later if he needs to. You also see he has that Grimm the Avenger in his hand already, I believe. It's either Grimm the Avenger or Glinda. Oh, it's Glinda. He's a Glinda in his hand, so he can make something unblockable if he needs to. He's debating whether or not to play that Horn of the Sacred Beast off the top. Hit a red-black stone. Play King in Yellow. Sacrifice them both to a Domberly. So I'm going to drain him for 400 damage. And get to bring back a King in Yellow. So I pay 200, he takes 400. Trying to save the Mozart for when he has maybe a little bit more pressure on the board. And knowing that he has Grimm the Avenger, playing something like Domberly is good because he can't hit it with Grimm the Avenger. So moving into his 2-drop, it makes it a much better position for me. Play the Cheshire Cat. I'm hoping he tries to play something that isn't hexproof, but that's, again, it puts me in a bad position if I try to use Mozart with Hoster, because he can just sacrifice the thing that's hexproof, and then I have to kill something of myself, my own, with the Hoster, which is not good. Passes the turn. So I'm not having to burn myself, which is lovely. I play the Guinevere. And I play Mozart. Oh no, I play King in Yellow. Being able to thin out my deck a little bit. And I swing in with the Adombrili. He decides to take that damage, putting him down this 3,000. And at the end of my turn, before Guinevere can make anything useful, he thunders it. It was a really strong play that's going to disrupt my tempo a lot. So, in Elliot's turn, he's able to make some plays here. Now he's got lots of cards in his hand. He's deciding whether he wants to get aggressive, ramp, or save his cancel spells and stuff like that to mess with my tempo even more. Because he does have a Zeke's in his hand. He decides he wants to try to ramp up a little bit more. So he has that Gretel. Luckily hits the Blastic Waves off the top, but he doesn't have a... Does he have a one drop? He decides to pass the turn, I think, at that point, saving the Thunder for later. So I draw on the turn. Tap for another stone. I want to try to play a little bit more cautiously here. Trying to play a little bit more slow and steady. Pay one, bring out Rasputin. Attempt to swing for 600 with Adombrili, which goes through, putting him down at 24. Attempt to swing in with the King in Yellow. I figure, why not? Let's try to get some damage in. Decides to accept that damage as well, putting him down to 2,000. I pay 2 to put out a Mozart, which helps me feel pretty good, kind of on the defensive, and I pass the turn. With a Levitine, I feel even better here, because then I can sacrifice the Mozart on command, but unfortunately, no such luck. For the upkeep, he's going to go ahead and pitch something. He's going to pitch. Looks like he's going to... He's thinking about thundering too. He decides to just let both of those things slide. He sees that I left on my little red the pure stone, I believe, so that if he tried to kill my King in Yellow, I could just pump it up. So he's going to go ahead and use Blessing of Yggdrasil to grab that second unyielding flame. This is one of those moments where I would love to have my Banzai attack. Because if I had Banzai attack, then I would definitely just win the game this position. But unfortunately, it did not show up in my hand. So, no such luck. So he just passes the turn to me. Before the upkeep, I'm going to go ahead and pump up my king in yellow, so now he's a 6/6 for the turn. I'm going to incarnate Mozart and Rasputin for Biaki. Probably should have just swung with Mozart first to try to get in some free damage. Puts him in a position where if he blocks, cool, there's a treasure guide gone. But if he blocks with Gretel, then he's going to lose two creatures. He's actually going to Zeke's my Biaki, which really sucks. And then I'm going to pay 200 life to bring back my Rasputin. And he's going to sacrifice the Gretel for the Mozart. Again, if I had attacked, it would have been 200 free damage. So I'm going to pay 1 to play Rasputin back onto the board. And then swing in for 600. And she is going to take, putting him down to 14. I'm going to swing in for another 600 with a Domberly. Figure I might as well at this point. To take that as well. Puts him down to 800. I'm going to go ahead and do what I did before and be in a secure position with a Mozart. I get a little greedy here, I'm not going to lie. It would have been better just to stop there. I'm actually going to go ahead and incarnate into Nyarlathotep, into Hoster, pay 200 to bring back my Rasputin, and then kill my king in yellow. I'll catch it here in a second, but I am gonna search. I get to search for the second king in yellow. Catch it here in a second. Maybe I do. Supposed to search off a king in yellow from the Hoster killing it. Pretty sure I catch it here in a second. This is why you always don't shortcut, kids, and you always remember your triggers. Maybe? There we go. I remember my king in yellow search now. So I'm feeling pretty good here in a position where even if he has a Grimm the Avenger, I have a Cthulhu, so he can't kill it. He's pretty low. I mean, he can commit to a matchstick girl at this point, but it would take a lot of his will. I don't know. I'm feeling okay here. He actually pitches a matchstick girl for a matchstick girl. I don't really know what the point of that was. It seems to me like that wasn't the best move. I mean, he already had a matchstick girl in hand. I don't see why he pitched it. Could do incarnation for 5. Awakening for 5. So he's gonna get 3 matchsticks. Double pump. He's gonna use 1, use 2. So my Nyarlathotep is now just permadead. And then he's gonna use the 3rd on Hoster to kill that. So draw on a turn. So again, I got a little greedy there. I really didn't see a need. There really wasn't a need for me to flip there. I could have just been more patient and waited until it was actually something that required some time. So I was not playing the most ideal that I could have during this game, but it was still a lot of fun. and it's good learning material for all of you guys. So here's another moment where I get a little bit too greedy. I play two kings in yellow and a Rasputin here, and fail to search, fail to bring back a... I don't even think about paying for a Rasputin to bring her back in my hand, and I play Yogg-Sothoth. Kills his little match girl, and I get to do swing in for 600 damage. There was no need. I mean, playing Yogg-Sothoth here is great, but the thing is, he's going to be able to search for a Grimm the Avenger, or just do Matchstick Girl. Again, do Awakening for 5 to bring back those 3 matches. And he can just spend 2 of those matches and just kill Yogg. He's dead. And then a 3rd match and kill Adomberly. So Yogg essentially just did nothing. So he passes the turn to me at this point. I tap for another stone. I only have 1 card in my hand, so I just pass. It's a Levatine. He swings in for 600 damage, which I'm going to go ahead and accept. And then he follows it up by playing Tinkerbell and starts ramping things up with Rapunzel and everything else. And he's dealing with a clear board, he might as well. And so he just passes the turn to me. I draw. And at that point, I just concede because I know that next turn he's going to be able to get aggressive even if I kill something with Flames of Outer World and I can't kill him. So I just go ahead and concede the match. So there you have it, guys. Let me know what you think about it in the comment section down below. And until next time, this is DMO73 signing off. Thank you.